This is part two of a critique of Pseudonautics, episode 3, Soft Landing. I left part one by insinuating that Guillaume boo-booed in his calculations of flow rate and exit velocity, so here's the data and calculations to back that up. VE, the effective velocity, is not the actual velocity of the exhaust gases. VE is defined as ISP, the specific impulse, times G0 in this case, the acceleration due to gravity. The specific impulse tells you what change momentum you can expect out of a kilogram of propellant. Basically, it's an efficiency rating, like miles per gallon is with an automobile. We'll come back to this page in a moment, but first, let's visit the rocket thrust simulator on NASA.gov. This, or a similar widget, is probably where Guillaume got his numbers. If you plug in the values I list on the right, you get a rocket with about 11 kilonewtons thrust and a flow rate of 3.41 kilograms per second. The exit velocity is 3,118 meters per second, slightly lower than the effective velocity of 3,225 meters per second, giving this engine an efficiency of 96.7%. And just where did I find the effective velocity on this page? Ah, you have to calculate it. No problem. We just learned how to do that. You multiply the specific impulse, in this case 329 seconds, by the gravitational constant of 9.8 meters per second squared, and you get 3,225 meters per second. What's that, you say? The gravitational constant for the moon is 1.6 meters per second squared? Oops. Looks like Guillaume used a rocket thrust simulator made for designing rockets that launch from the Earth, not the moon. The gravitational constant of 9.8 meters per second squared is hardwired into the simulator because, well, the Earth is where most people would launch rockets from. Does that make sense? Anyway, this is obviously how Guillaume got his numbers. To prove these numbers don't work on the moon, let's return to Wikipedia and calculate the specific impulse for an effective velocity of 3,225 meters per second if G0 is 1.6 meters per second squared. We get 2,016 seconds, which is way too high for a chemical rocket engine. The specific impulse for the limb descent engine is usually quoted to be in the range of 300 to 315, depending on whether the 10-inch extension is included in the nozzle or not. This value is widely available on the internet. Wikipedia, for example. Another good source, and a little more original, is the DPS performance reports that were filed after each mission. Take this report for the Apollo 14, for example. There's even a table of performance data in the middle of the report that lists the specific impulse at four different times during the descent. The effective velocity is closer to 480 meters per second than to 3,200 meters per second. This turns Guillaume's blazing bullet into a slow-pitch softball. Then he comes up with this nonsense on the divergence angle of the exhaust. 5 to 10 degrees? I assume that's on both sides. He justifies this error by saying that a vacuum doesn't slow down the gases. Dude, at least shoot for an ultra-conservative 50 degrees. That's 25 on each side. But hey, who cares? Let's go with the numbers that Guillaume estimated. It's only fair that we should use an area that's too small, along with a gas velocity that's too big. Let's go with it and see what happens. After all, if we start making corrections now, we won't be able to check the rest of his work. Oh, by the way, if the area of the nozzle is 1.38 meters squared, and 5 meters away it spreads to 3 meters squared, then he's using a divergence angle of 3.6 degrees on each side, which is smaller than the 5 degrees he said is a minimum. Why does that surprise me? That, of course, makes the area on the surface from 5 meters even smaller. But it also messes with the 1.75 meter area. This is supposed to be the area under the nozzle when the lunar module is sitting on the surface. But the height Guillaume had to use is 1 1/3 meters, or 52 inches, and is way too high, and I'm really getting tired of catching all these mistakes. But we'll let Guillaume's numbers ride. Who cares? So, we have hot gases pressing on the lunar surface at exceedingly high velocity. Well then, what is the dynamic pressure of this gas on the lunar surface? Glad you asked. The space between the nozzle and the lunar surface is a frustum of a cone. The pointy end is cut off. The top base, the nozzle end, has a 1.38 meter area. The bottom base at the lunar surface has a 1.75 meter area. The height is 1 1/3 meters, derived earlier from Guillaume's calculations. That makes the volume 2.57 meters cubed. The gas is moving through this volume at, let's use Guillaume's numbers again, 3,225 meters per second. So to travel 1 1/3 meters takes 412 microseconds. The total mass in this volume is the flow rate, use Guillaume's 3.41 kilograms per second, times the 412 microseconds, which equals 1.4 grams. Divide that into the volume, and you get a density of 0.55 grams per meter cubed. Now, according to the kinetic theory of ideal gases, the pressure of this gas is the average momentum transfer per unit area per unit of time. So 1/3 the density times the velocity squared gives us 1,897 kilograms per meter second squared, or 1,897 pascals. That's 0.275 psi absolute. Guillaume never calculates the dynamic pressure as I've done here, of course, but he mentions that debunkers like to use the less impressive static pressure number of 6.2 kilopascals. That's 0.9 psi, and more than three times larger than its dynamic pressure. So, which is really less impressive? To put these numbers in perspective, consider this. There are four landing pads on the limb. If the limb weighs 11 kilonewtons, each pad bears 2 3/4 kilonewtons, 1/4 of the limb's total weight. A 36-inch or 0.9 meter diameter pad is 0.66 square meters, so each pad presses on the lunar surface with 4.2 kilopascal. You would expect each pad should be buried at least a couple of inches into lunar regolith. Instead, this Apollo 14 pad is clearly not buried. I'll assume that Guillaume will agree with my calculation for dynamic pressure, because later he calculates the equivalent atmospheric wind speed of the exhaust, and using the numbers we get here for pressure and density and the erroneous equation shown on this drawing, I get a wind speed only 15% lower than his, which is as close as I've come on any of his numbers. By the way, I have no idea what he's doing here. I've never seen this equation before. One thing is obvious. If you just reduce the units, you definitely don't end up with meters per second. So this equation doesn't give you the speed of anything. Actually, this looks like an abortion of the dynamic pressure equation that we used earlier. If that's what he meant, then the velocity should be 3,225, the same velocity he had to have used to calculate the pressure and density he used in this equation. And if you take 3,225 to the 2/3 power, you get the same number we calculated earlier. So even when Guillaume uses a bogus equation, his calculations still come out a little high. If only he had shown his work. If he really wanted an equivalent Earth wind speed, he should have realized that the product of velocity and density gives you the rate of molecules hitting you in the face. Since the density of air at sea level, 1.2 kilograms per meter cubed, is more than 2,000 times the density of the exhaust gas, the equivalent wind speed is a gentle 3.3 miles per hour. I suspect Guillaume might have done this calculation and wasn't impressed with the numbers. I do have to give Guillaume credit for this analogy, though. I never would have thought of calculating the effect of Earth wind speed if he hadn't tried to do it. But anyway, where does this take us? With all this dynamic pressure and such, what could possibly happen? What happens is, we don't have enough time left in this video to go into what happens. I apologize. I really didn't intend to get this involved, but there are just so many errors in Guillaume's math. It's taking longer than I expected to get through them. Oh well, we still need to review Guillaume's energy equations and see if they make sense, and we need to look at some surprising data that Guillaume thinks supports his claims. So, we'll see you in part 3. Ciao, Moon Hoax conspirators, wherever you are.